Well, good morning, Santa Ranch. How are you all doing today? Good to see you all out today. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Our God is always worthy of our praise. No matter what's going on in your life, no matter how you feel, He is indeed worthy because He is in control. Amen. Come on, stand to your feet. Let's bless Him. Song says, let's give Him every praise because He deserves it.
Good morning, and good morning to everyone at home. If you're listening live stream, or if you are coming to see us at a later time, welcome. We're so glad you're here. If this is your first time, we do have a blue card in our pamphlet. I would love for you to fill that out for us so that we can connect with you. If this is your first time, we would also love to connect with you before you leave. Would the rest of you please bow your heads and pray with me? Lord God, Heavenly Father, King of Glory, please be in this place, Lord, this Sunday. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this time where we can be together and we can worship you, Lord. Thank you, God, for Oliver's talent and how he can just fill this place with music, Lord, and lead our hearts to turn to you and to praise your name, Lord God. Thank you, God, for Doyle, for stepping up during this time and using his voice and his talents, God, to lead us to grow closer to you, Lord. God, we're so thankful for Doyle and his family being here and just, God, how they're serving Sienna Ranch in this time. Lord, we pray for the future of our church at Sienna Ranch. God, you are moving and we feel you here. And we know, God, that you have come before us and you have prepared a way. And so, Lord, we look to you to guide us on this path, Lord, in so many different ways. Thank you for already knowing our future as a church, Lord, and that as each one of us, God. You know our hearts, you know our needs, you know our desires, Lord. And so you have a relationship with each one of us. And so, God, today I pray that you speak to us. You speak to each one of us, whispering to our hearts. And that our relationship with you can continue to grow, Lord. God, thank you for such a beautiful day, even though it's overcast and drizzly. Lord God, we're looking forward to some cooler weather. Thank you, God. Thank you for this day. We praise your name. Amen.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone. Mercy fills the streets to look upon the one who bled to save us and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day. There will be a day when all bow before him. There will be a when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died, he rose up again. Holy, holy is the Lord. In every prayer we pray with inspiration, a song of faith. Sang through doubt and fear. In the end, we see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. Say there will be a day when all about. One voice, a thousand.
I won't be your girl. reach out for the Spirit of the living God and invite him to speak to our heart today. Speak to us where we live so that we can be made the better. Come on, say, Spirit of the living God.
Spirit of the living God. Spirit of the living God. We only want to hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God. Spirit of the living God. We want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word.
Thank you.
Songs so speak to where we are today. We are looking to you for guidance, for direction. As we look to fill the hole of a lead pastor, we look to you, oh God, and we invite you, Spirit of the Living God, to speak to us, not just individually, oh God, but corporately, as a local body. We open our hearts, we open our minds to hear you. Come to that place that we call being on one accord. Lord, we bless you and we thank you in advance that you're moving even now. We thank you that the victory is already ours and that we can say hallelujah, our God reigns, because you reign in this place. But the unity and the harmony that only you give. We thank you, God, for today's word, that you will speak to our hearts and that you'll move us as we taken on this journey, that you'll move us further down the road so that we can do the work you've called us to, walk in those great works you've called us to. We bless you now in Jesus' name. Everyone that agreed said amen.
Amen.
And amen. You may be seated.
This is awesome. I have all these kids. Good morning. How are you guys? Good, good. Well, that last song is really cool because it talks about how God is the one who sets in our hearts, who tells us to move, who tells us what to do and what to seek and what to see, and that's because he is holy. We have talked about the word holy for the past 4 weeks, so I'm going to show you a couple of things in this bag that it's not that they're holy, but there's something about them that I will tell you in a minute. Okay, here we go. We have a toothbrush. Weird, right? What does that have to do with God? I don't know. So there's that. We have a hairbrush with my hair in it. Ooh, that's kind of gross. So there's that. And we have a toilet brush or a shower brush. So what does that have to do with God? Okay, no, you don't know. No, hold on, hold on. Okay, Mike, would you brush your teeth with this?
No.
No. Would you clean your shower maybe with this?
Yes.
Okay, so this guy right here is set apart to do a special thing, and that is to clean a shower or a floor. Okay, there you go. Mike, or let's see, Christina, would you brush your hair with this maybe? I guess you could. You could. Oh, yeah, you could do eyebrows or something. Yeah, but normally what is it used for?
Teeth.
Brush your teeth. So this is set apart for something special to do, which is to brush your teeth, okay? This right here, you could do a lot with it, actually. You could brush your dog. You could brush your own hair. You could maybe brush your couch or something, the hair off the couch. I don't know. You could do several things. But what is it normally used for, Marnie? Brushing your hair. So this is set apart and special for brushing your hair or your dog's hair. You could do that. So here we have three different brushes, a cleaning brush for, like, utilities, a toothbrush for your teeth or your dog's teeth. You could do that. Or your eyebrows. And then a hairbrush for hair. Each has its own special purpose. Now, guys, this is what I want you to know. This is very important. Put your hand down. Very important. Always remember this. God, Caleb, has you set apart for something special too. He has you set apart for a purpose, and that is to bring glory to him, to love him, and all the things that you do, little boys,
in all the ways, in your creative, fun, amazing ways, God has a purpose for you. You're special and you're set apart because God is holy and he lives in you. By who? Who did God leave to stay and be with you? Who? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. Isn't that the coolest thing ever? Okay, so we're going to go back to the back, and we're going to learn a little bit more about how God, to the training station, about how God is special in his way and holy, and then you guys, about how you're special. Oh, my gosh.
Can you stand, maybe stand up real quick? So, I think you won something. You won something. So, as most of you probably already know, this is Mandy's last Sunday with us, and we are so grateful and thankful for Mandy and all that you have done for our kids. God has definitely set you apart for that, and so we're, another round of applause. It's really amazing story how she even came to me to help serve and then ended up becoming doing the children's ministry. There'll be a book coming out about that, I'm sure, pretty soon. But really, we just appreciate you, the Sunday nights, the Wednesday nights, the different activities with the kids. And I don't know how much of y'all know, but she has done far more than just that. You know, whether it's been a marriage date night, events at the church, the thing with Mark, she's always jumped in and helped do multiple things. So. Yeah. So we're going to miss you. We appreciate you. God didn't answer my prayers because I was praying that the whole move thing wasn't going to happen for a long time. So, but we're thankful for you. I'm glad you're coming back once a month for 5/11. That's awesome. So, but again, thank you so much. We love you. Appreciate you. Okay, I'm just kidding.
Sorry to cut you off. It has been my joy and my pleasure to do this. So thank you for letting me come and spend the last year here in Siena doing the best thing ever, working with the kids and you guys. You are just amazing and so special. I will hopefully come back to do the 5/11. It'd be so cool. I just can't say more. Just thank you so much. Thank you.
I went from earlier wanting to cry as Oliver was giving us the praise music, and then with Mandy saying that tearful goodbye, I wanted to break out into a Barry Manilow song about Mandy. Oh, Mandy. How you guys doing? Good, 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 good. Yeah, I was attempting to hold back the tears earlier as the Oliver was singing. I was telling my wife earlier how forward I'm looking for heaven. And now I'm not going to go out and do something bad to myself, no. But I'm looking forward to seeing the Lord. I'm looking forward to seeing all that he has in store for us there. And when he started on that portion of the song that says, "Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever all my day I will praise." And I wanted to shout then. Yeah. I wanted to shout right then and there. And if you're not getting excited about going to see your God, if you're not excited about going to see all the things in heaven, if you're not excited about seeing all the loved ones that preceded you going to glory, you need a preventative maintenance check. Amen? Because I'm so excited about seeing the Lord. Are we going to continue with the series, The Scarlet Thread, this second portion of this four-part series? And I'm just going to ask you that you would be praying for me like I did the last time. No fooling, be serious, no, pray for me. I don't want any of this to be about me. I'm so excited and overwhelmed just to be here at home. I love the worshipful atmosphere here, the familiar faces. I am in my zone, y'all. I am in my zone. I'm at home. Can I take my shoes and socks off, y'all? Amen. Open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9. And I'm reading, as is my norm, from that New King James Version of the Bible. And would you do me a favor out of respect and honor for God's Word? Would you stand for the reading of God's Word? Nevertheless, the gloom will not be upon her who is distressed, as when at first he did lightly esteemed the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterwards more heavily oppressed her by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan in Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every warrior's sandal from the noisy battle and garments rolled in blood will be used for burning fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice, from that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. And I want to use for a subject and for your consideration, the Prince of Peace piercing the darkness. You may be seated. The Prince of Peace piercing the darkness. Heavenly Father, I'm delighted and I'm honored and overwhelmed at the same time that I have this opportunity to stand in your presence and before your people to proclaim your holy word. I only ask, Father, that you let the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight, that you will be honored, Lord God, by what is said. Lord, forgive my mistakes or errors, and let them not see me, let them see you. I love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus is the believer's deliverer. And when the enemy threatens his children, he is and always will be our rescuer. His brightness pierces through the darkness and the gloom of his people. Believers have witnessed that deliverance throughout biblical and human history. One such example is the American Civil War. Those were some of the darkest days of our nation. Let me just take you back there for a moment. It was Richmond, Virginia, and the capital of the Confederate States of America had fallen to the Union forces on April 3rd, 1865. The following day on April 4th, 1865, started early for Abraham Lincoln. He began the day with quiet resolve to personally walk the streets of the fallen rebel capital. He left Washington that morning on the ship, the River Queen, and stayed with her as far as Varina. He disembarked and was taken by army escort to the outskirts of Richmond. At about 11 a.m., Mr. Lincoln entered the city of Richmond on foot, accompanied by Admiral Porter and Captain Bell and a small detachment of men, about a half a dozen soldiers. Crowds thronged the streets. Chief and eager among them were the emancipated, wishing to pay homage and give thanks to their great emancipator. As Lincoln walked the streets of Richmond that day, a small boy clutched his hand and walked by his side. The small boy was Tad Lincoln, the president's own son, whom the president had taken with him to the fallen rebel city on his birthday. This day, April 4th, 1865, was one of Mr. Lincoln's last. He fell victim of the assassin John Wilkes Booth 10 short days afterwards. As Mr. Lincoln and his son walked the streets of Richmond, one group, newly freed slaves, cried out, "Glory, hallelujah," and fell to their knees before Mr. Lincoln. This brings to mind the image of Christ entering Jerusalem, riding on the foal of a donkey, led by his disciples and a throng of people surrounding him, laying palm branches before him and crying, "Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who cometh in the name of the Lord." It was here that Lincoln paused for a moment and looked. But then he motioned to them to rise, saying, "Don't kneel to me. You must kneel only to God and thank him for your freedom. Liberty is your birthright. God gave it to you as he gave it to others. And it is a sin that you have been deprived of it for so many years." And after more than 200 years of slavery and nearly 5 years of a bloody civil war where 600,000 plus Americans lost their lives, a light shined in darkness. Freedom for the slave and peace for our nation had come. And brothers and sisters, just as in those days, we today have great challenges and struggles. But make no doubt about it, make no mistake, Sienna Ranch, God will shine through the darkness, through the trials, through the tests. How can I be so certain of this? Because we are his children, and he will not abandon us. We too can say, as they did that day in Jerusalem, "Glory, hallelujah, hosanna to the highest. Blessed is the Lord. Blessed is he that comes in his name." We're going to be all right, Sienna Ranch. We're going to make it, Sienna Ranch. You're going to get through, Sienna Ranch. You're going to triumph. Somebody say amen. You're going to triumph, Sienna Ranch. In chapter 8 of Isaiah, the prophet has told the people of Israel that they would find themselves in a dark and threatening situation. They would be gripped with fear and distress in heart, that theirs would be despair and hopelessness. War would tear through the nation, and their enemy, the Assyrians, would sweep across Israel and down into Judah like a great flood. This would truly be a dark and dismal and dreadful time for them. This devastating invasion of the Assyrians was a prophecy yet still to come, however. It hadn't yet happened, but Isaiah was warning them that their sin, their rebellion against God, would bring this certain and terrible calamity upon them, that their disobedience and wickedness would be the reason for the coming anguish and distress. Isaiah, however, didn't stop there. He gave them a word of hope. A word of hope. Among the wonderful promise, just as God sent an emancipator to the American slave, just as he ended the carnage and bloodshed of civil war, the people of Israel will be delivered by God's light, his presence, his shining in the agonizing despair of this world. He would send a prince who would pierce through the darkness of their lives. He promised a bright future. In the midst of what they were about to go through, in the midst of what they were experiencing, he promised them, and he promises you and I, no matter how dark it may get, no matter how rough it may get, brighter days are what? Ahead. Look at verse 1. He says, "Nevertheless, the gloom will not be upon her who is distressed." Your translation may say, the gloom will no more be upon those who are distressed. And when at first he lightly esteemed or caused them to be afflicted, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterwards some more heavily oppressed her by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan and the Galilee of the Gentiles. He's telling them when this was going to happen and what course it was going to take. But he tells them that they will emerge out of that darkness. See, God, through the prophet Isaiah, wanted Israel, the northern kingdom, he wanted to warn them that a time of gloom and darkness would be coming upon them because of their wickedness. The time would come, however, when that gloom would no longer be upon them, upon those who are distressed. And this is coming upon them again because of their rebellion. There can be no good results when we rebel against God, brothers and sisters. Can you remember when you told your mama and your daddy in no uncertain terms, no? That didn't end so well, did it? And it never does. When we tell our Heavenly Father, no, he must respond. He must answer. Israel had rebelled. Israel had rejected Judah, their sister nation, and aligned herself with Rezin, who was the king of Assyria, along with Pekah, king of Israel. And they surrounded Jerusalem to make war against her. And because Israel then preferred the enemy over their sister nation, God said through Isaiah in chapter 8, verse 6, "The people refuse the waters of Shiloah that flow softly and rejoice in Rezin and Remaliah, the son of Pekah, the king of Israel." In other words, he's saying they would rather go with the enemy of God than the people of God. They made a choice. They made a poor one, but they made a choice to rebel against God. In essence, the northern kingdom made an alliance with the Gentile nation and God's enemy rather than trusting in him. Not only did Israel rebel against God, she warred against Judah. And how many of you know, as I said earlier, there's a consequence. There's always a consequence with sin and rebellion. As a result of Israel's rebellion and betrayal, the Assyrian army would sweep over them like a mighty flood. As the Euphrates River overflows the bank, the Assyrians would overflow and run over Israel. where it says in that seventh verse of chapter 8, "Now therefore the king of Assyria and all his glory, he will go up over all the channels and go over his banks. They would be overrun. If Israel would make alliances with a Gentile nation, then God would overwhelm them like a flood running over its bank." Isaiah said, so shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory to the rising of the sun, when the enemy comes in like a flood. There's a consequence, brothers and sisters. But don't you know, as I said last week, we don't sin in a vacuum. Someone is always impacted by our sin. So it is with Judah. Now, everyone knows that Israel was a terrible kingdom. They didn't have one good king. Judah, on the other hand, did. Judah had a few good kings, not all of them, but a few good kings. But the problem was that Israel's rebellion impacted and affected Judah as well. And that's what I mean, that we do not sin in a vacuum. If we live rebelliously before others, it will impact them. And somehow Judah kind of picked up on their rebellion. It said that the Syrian army didn't stop with Israel, but swooped down into Judah, nearly overtaking them also. In verse 8 of chapter 8, it says, "He will pass through," speaking of Assyria, "he will pass through Judah, he will overwhelm and pass over. He will reach up to the neck and stretch out, and his wings will fill the breadth of the land, O Emmanuel." How many of you know that sin is cancerous? Sin is malignant. Sin spreads and prevails and pervades itself. Sin is an awful thing for the people of God to be in. And Israel is experiencing that now. Zebulun and Naphtali will be the region through which the armies march through Israel and then around the Sea of Galilee and down the Jordan River and reach Judah. It was spread. Probably every person in this room has a smartphone. If you got a smartphone, hold your hand in it. If there's a calculator on that phone, yeah. When we use calculators and we make a mistake, what do? We delete. Clear, right? And when we delete it, our mistakes are gone, right? But God treats us the same way, like that calculator. When we sin, when we make a mistake, when we go the wrong way, if we repent, God pushes the what? Delete or clear button. It doesn't stop us from suffering the consequence of our sin, but it keeps us from experiencing the eternal consequences of that sin. God will delete that. God will not ignore nor overlook our sin and rebellion. He will remove and he will reprove and rebuke his people. He will smite us and bruise us, for he is a holy God. But from that same holy and righteous Father who judges us proceeds love, proceeds grace and forgiveness. The bruises that he inflicts, he will heal. The tears that he provokes, he will wipe away. Our God is a loving, compassionate, and forgiving God. Amen? Question: will we receive the love and forgiveness?
He means us no harm and no hurt. He is a loving Father, wanting to guide us safely under his wings. Look at verse 2 and 5. Verse 2 and 5 of Isaiah 9. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them the light has shined. Ye have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoils. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every soldier's sandal from the noisy battle and garment rolled in blood will be used for burning of fire. God gives them great hope through Isaiah. He tells them that you are afflicted now, but you will be delivered later. And how does this hope come? Through whom does this hope come from? Jesus Christ. He's the hope. He's the light in this world. John said, then Jesus spoke again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. 700 years later, Isaiah is letting Israel know that the Messiah is coming, the Prince is coming, the Deliverer is coming. And Jesus is that Deliverer. He is that hope. And he will pour out his blessings upon us. He will give light to all who were held in bondage of darkness and death. A person who walks in darkness is a person who cannot see where he is or where he's going or where he's been. But the psalmist said this. He says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Amen. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom should I be afraid? And again, he says, the word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Notice that when he used that word earlier, he's talking about expanding. He really means protecting. Jesus will enlarge or protect the nation, our believers, and increase their joy. He will deliver them all out of their troubles. The Messiah will bring joy that will fill their hearts as in the time of harvest or as when the spoils of war are divided. He will deliver them all those who are under the yoke of bondage and oppression. Just as God gave Gideon victory over the Midianites, he will give us victory in our trials. He promises hope. It doesn't matter what the obstacle or circumstances are. Paul said this in 2 Timothy 4 and 18. And the Lord will deliver me from every evil work and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. In the book entitled Adrift, there's a story of a man who built a boat, a vessel, and he wanted to sail the Atlantic Ocean. And he sailed in a circular course, but then he hit bad weather, and the vessel went down. And when the vessel went down, he was stranded for 80 days on a raft, and he began to lose hope. He began to lose hope. Things were looking mighty bad for him. But then he would become hopeful again when he would get close to a shipping lane where the ships would go from one coast to another coast to bring their products, but he would miss that ship and he would lose hope again. But he thought about something. He thought, if I just can get closer to that lane, someone will pick me up. And it's a saying, it's been said, that we can live 40 days without food. We can live 8 days without water. We can live 4 minutes without air, but only a few minutes without hope. We need hope. Israel had been living in a bad condition. They had continued disobeying God, and that disobedience had brought judgment. Those times of judgment would be grievous. But Isaiah said that God in his love and mercy would bring them out of the darkness and that he would give them hope. Brothers and sisters, we can't live without hope. The hope that God shall supply all our needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. We need that hope. We need a hope that gives us strength for our journey. We need a hope to overcome this evil world. We need a hope of spending eternity with him. I have a question, Santa Ranch. Do you have hope? Do you have hope? So he promises a bright future. He assures them of hope to come, that hope would come through a Messiah. The Messiah is Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is that prince. That prince who would pierce the darkness of our situations. That prince that would pierce all the moments of our struggles. That prince that will get us through our situations. He said, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government would be upon his shoulder. And his name would be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there would be no end, upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. This prince, this Messiah, he wasn't like any other man. There's no man like him. He was a special man. As a matter of fact, he was and is the God man. They have a highfalutin word for that. It's called the hypostatic union. Jesus is comprised of both deity and humanity. In other words, he's all God and he's all man at the same time. Now, if you try to figure that out, don't do it, because we have to put you in a straitjacket. You won't be able to figure it out. But that's who he is. That's why he can relate to us. That's why they call him the Son of Man, so he can relate to us. But then he's called the Son of who? God, that he relates to the Father. He's all-encompassing. He is the God-man. Not only is he the God-man, God encased in flesh, the incarnate God who is now glorified. It says that he will govern. The Messiah will come to govern. He will rule the whole world, executing perfect righteousness and justice among the people. How many of us are experiencing perfect justice today? That's a short supply right now in this country. There's no perfect justice today. There will be no two-tier justice system, as we are witnessing today in our staggering, stumbling national government. There will be one form of justice for the rich. There will not be one form of justice for the rich and another for the poor. One for the powerful and one for the weak. No, this government ruled by the Messiah will be a perfect government. Perfect justice will be the standard of rule. And I'm looking forward to that day. He wants to see your color of your eyes. He wants to see how much you got in your wallet. He won't care how degreed you are or how illiterate you are. None of that will matter. He will rule and govern in perfect justice. Michael said in 5:2, "But you, Bethlehem, Ephratah, though you are little among thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth is from old, from everlasting." So it doesn't matter how small you are. You could be a nobody, but you're somebody to Jesus. I like how the old slave said to the master. He was sitting out on a porch one day and he was sitting on a porch with a friend, and he had this slave come out and say, "Hey, Joe, come and sing this song for me and my guests." And so Joe comes and he sings this little slave song, entertaining his guests. And so later on, the master was riding his horse across the field, and he tried to jump this fence on the horse and fell off the horse. And old Joe saw him fall. And one day, the master asked Joe to sing another song for his friend. And this is the song he said. He said, "Jackass reared, jackass rode, threw old master to the floor." What he was saying, he said, "I was once the bottom rail, but I'm the top rail now." See, you might feel like you're the bottom rail right now, but one day you will be the top rail. You won't be down here. You will be up here. Because his justice is what? Perfect. His justice is perfect. So he's going to govern in perfection. Zechariah 14:9 says, "And the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day it shall be the Lord is one, and his name is one." So he's going to rule with justice because he can do it. He's the God, man. He's the perfect man. He's God incarnate. And we're going to praise him for it. We're going to praise him for his wonderful attributes. And one attribute is simply inadequate to express or describe the extent of the Messiah's excellence and superiority. The Bible says he will be called Wonderful Counselor. Peleus, that word means extraordinary. There's none like him. No one is going to be like him. He has the answer to all a man's problems. That one, he's going to be an extraordinary counselor. You'll be called the Mighty God. The Mighty God. He is going to be omniscient, meaning he knows all things. He's going to be omnipresent. That means he's going to be everywhere at the same time. He's omnipotent. It means he's all powerful. He's going to be immutable, meaning he will never change. This is the Prince. He'll be called the Everlasting Father, meaning that he's of the order of Melchizedek. He is without beginning and without end. See, he doesn't exist within time and space, but time and space exist within him. Like how the old preacher you said before, there was a then or there, a when or a where, there was God. This is the Prince that is coming. If anyone asks which comes first, the chicken or the egg, you tell them God came first. God came first. For all things come from and have their existence in him. In him we move, we breathe, and we have our being. He'll be called the Prince of Peace. He'll bring peace to the hearts of men. Peace between nations of the world. Peace between God and humankind. Paul said, "He himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has torn down the dividing walls of hostility." How will he do this? Our Heavenly Father would guarantee it by zeal, by a burning passion flooding the heart of God, a passion to make absolutely sure the promise of the coming Messiah is fulfilled. Nothing can prevent it. Nothing can stop the fulfillment of this prophecy. Lonely? No. I'm not lonely with Jesus standing by. His presence always cheers me. I know that he is nigh. Friendless? No. I'm not friendless. Since Jesus is my friend, I change, but he remaineth true, faithful to the end. Saddened? No, I'm not saddened by scenes of deep woe. I should be if I knew now that Jesus loves me so. Tired? No, I'm not tired while leaning on his breast. My soul has full enjoyment of his eternal rest. In Jesus Christ, y'all, we have perfect peace and security. He keeps those in perfect peace whose mind stayed on him. So we needn't be lonely. We needn't be friendless. We needn't be saddened. We needn't be tired. Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and he pierces through the darkness of life's troubles. Do you trust him? Will you rely on him in your most desperate hour? He has asked you to do so. He has said, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The psalmist says this. He says, cast your burden on the Lord, and he shall sustain you. He shall never permit the righteous to be moved. And I submit to you, Sienna Ranch, as I take my seat, that Jesus is that Prince of Peace. He is the one who pierces the darkness. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, so grateful that even in the times of despair, struggle, hardship, you have already made a way. You have already slain the darkness. You sent your son. You sent the prince from eternity past to this very moment, even into the future. You're foretold and tell of your son. And we thank you, Lord God, for that prince, the one who pierces the darkness. Amen.
Thank you, Doyle. Appreciate you, man. Appreciate that message. Got a couple of announcements. We actually only have 27 announcements this morning, so hold your seat. Just kidding. It's only 26. But, hey, if you are visiting with us, we are super glad that you're here. There's a blue connection card, again, in your bulletin. If you have the time before you leave this morning, there's a white box in the back. We really love to know that you visit with us this morning. If there's anything we can do for you, you can just put this in the box in the back. And again, we'd love to meet you and hope you enjoyed the service this morning. Also, okay, so coming up here, okay, get ready. Buckle your seatbelt. Okay, this Thursday, we have some art classes by our own very own Crystal Billing that's going to start up here on Thursday. It's inside your bulletin if you want some more information about that. It'll be Thursday nights for 12 and up. It's $90 for 9 weeks. It's $10 a week. So, just saying. Anyways, so but she's a very talented artist, and so I know that you'll really enjoy that. If again, 12 and up, so you can speak with her afterwards. But come check it out on Thursday night. Also, this is the last time I'm going to announce this. The Freedom Festival, we have announced this quite a bit up here, but this is coming this Friday up here at the church, starting at 5:30. And this is Sam Kissel's project for his trail life. It's comparable to like an Eagle Scout project. And he has a huge Freedom Festival going on up here. A number of people are going to be up here doing music. We have bounce houses. We have some food trucks going to be up here. And this is to raise money for the future playground up here at the church. So I think he has about almost 200 tickets that he's already sold for it. So hopefully if you've bought a ticket, you can come be a part of that. Invite some friends. It's going to be an awesome, awesome night. But that'll be this Friday. Then on Sunday night, April 2nd at 6 to 8 p.m., we're going to have a family meeting, a church meeting. So this meeting will be an opportunity for us to really kind of just share the direction and sense of the elders and staff, how what we had, sense God's doing in our church and where God has taken our church, and also an opportunity to hear from you, the church body, about some of the things that, that you see God doing. And we have a church survey, a need survey that we have as well to get that done. And there'll be an update from the pastor search committee as well. So be sure to be here next Sunday night from 6 to 8 p.m. The last thing I want to mention to you is Easter is coming up on April 9th. We're very excited. I wish you guys were a part of the meeting that we had up here on Thursday. It was an all staff slash other people as well meeting. And just the anticipation and excitement from the people in that room about what God's doing in this church. I mean, everybody was so excited about what God's doing, about what we see God doing in the future. So Easter Sunday, you know, it's the largest attendance day in churches traditionally across the U.S. or maybe the world. But we want to really create an opportunity for you to be able to invite people on Easter Sunday as we celebrate the risen Lord. An email got sent out last night about that. Again, from 10 to 10:30, we'll have food out here, a big spread that you can grab some food to eat. We're going to have a tent outside that you can go out to some tables and visit with some people as well. We're going to have a bounce house in the back. Unfortunately, the cannons to shoot kids out of got stuck on a shipping container out in the ocean. Not going to be able to have that maybe next year. So, but just want to encourage you to really think through about those in your life that you can invite. Again, our goal this Easter is to make a personal connection. And I know that some of you maybe are in this church that came through a personal invite. And you never really know what God's doing in someone's life. So we had somebody actually in our meeting say that they were committing to inviting 25 people to Easter. So I know the number of families are going to be here. They're going to be first-time visitors. So just be praying and think, who in my life do I have a connection with that I can personally invite? The email that got sent out last night has a graphic. You can download that, save that on your phone. There's a thing on your phone called text messaging. You can send that out, text message to people. You can post that on Facebook as well, or Twitter, whatever your social media tool is that you use. So, but we're excited. We're excited about what God's doing here at Santa Ranch and the future of Santa Ranch. And let's all just get together, encourage people to invite some people. We're looking forward to Easter Sunday. All right.
Wow. Who knew you could text on a phone? Who'd have thought? Come on, stand to your feet. How great is our God? Take me home.
church in the train station room right now. People can meet in there and pray for the church.
One more time.